Okay, well, I know we have a few more people that are waiting to join us, but we will go ahead and get started. So hello and welcome, everyone. My name is Crystal Barkas. I'm the Vice President of Operations at the Thurston County Chamber of Commerce. And thank you all for being a part of the Business Essentials during the Time of COVID webinar series. Once again, Business Essentials is a webinar series focused on providing you with information to help your business survive and thrive during and now beyond the times of COVID. The Chamber has been hosting Business Essentials since the beginning of the Stay Home, Stay Healthy order, with a variety of topics such as managing your remote workforce, creating your own user-generated content, digital marketing, insurance updates, and upscaling your technology for a disaster, and also recently complying with LMI protocols as it relates to reopening. All of our Business Essential webinars have been recorded and can be found on the Thurston Chamber's website. Today's webinar is sponsored by Cap City Law and Edward Jones Dirk Farrar. And today we have the pleasure of hearing from Michelle Goyette and Emory Lunsford with Brandman University. Our topic today is boosting employee morale during times of crisis. Michelle and Emory will focus on what may affect morale, how to boost morale, and the business impacts that it may have. During the presentation, we encourage all attendees to use the Q&A or chat feature. We will do our best to address any of your questions. And I know, Michelle's going to be reaching out during the webinar, so please ask questions as we are moving forward through the presentation. If at any time your question is not answered and we run out of time, we will definitely follow up with you following today's webinar. And we will also be sending a copy of today's presentation to all of those who registered. So with that, I'm gonna turn this over to Emory and Michelle, and thank you all again. Thank you, Emory, thank you, Michelle.
Thank you for joining us. Let me share my screen. We appreciate all of your time today. Like we said, if you have questions along the way, please don't hesitate to ask. Can everyone see my screen okay?
Yes.
Great. So Emory, if you would like to introduce yourself, then I'll introduce myself.
Thank you, Michelle. Yes, my name is Emory Lunsford. I've been with Brandman for a little over 5 years. I am an alumni of one of the programs from McCord Air Force Base, retired Air Force. And I do all of their outreach in the state of Washington and all of the military outreach across the nation.
Just a wee bit busy, huh? And I'm Michelle Goyette. I'm located in Southern California out of our main campus in Irvine, usually. I handle our national partnerships, help do trainings, work with HR departments, really quite broad. Been with Brandman for about 3 years. We both are extremely busy, and we're actually both also enrolled at Brandman as well. So we prove that you can do it all, right, Emory?
That's right.
Can be done. So we're going to be go ahead.
No, you're good.
So today we're going to go over employee morale, and there'll be quite a few different topics that we're covering. So like I said, if you have your own personal experience, if there's something that you found that works well, then please share with the group. This is really to be involved and really collaborative. This is based upon research and readings and some CHROs that I interviewed and things of that sort, but this is definitely, we welcome your input. Take it away, Emory.
So strong morale is always an essential part. So especially today, you know, we're faced with a lot of things going on in this country that we've never, ever seen before. So it's extremely important now to do that.
Absolutely. And while maintaining your morale now is so very important for the long run. It's always important, and it involves recruitment, retention, developing. It's all based around how high is the morale, how happy are people, how are people talking about your organization, and how do they feel supported all the time, let alone right now. So the impact that you're making now will drastically impact business in the future. Organizations that make the extra effort now to keep employees informed and engaged around these developments and to equip them with the skills and tools they will need to thrive today and tomorrow will be planting the seeds for future sustainability and growth. First tip.
So paying attention to everybody's workload. That's an extremely important one, especially since we're all remote most of us are virtually working, but those that are in the house may not be fully staffed, and so you must pay attention to your employees' workload.
Absolutely. And the data says that 72% of upper management and 66% of middle managers say that their job has become more demanding. So I don't know about you all, but my ability to have that work-life balance has been very tested. I wake up early, so I go straight to the computer. If a meeting goes over, if somebody wants to do a late webinar, I will do those things. So it's really helping your employees to understand what their workload is and support them into balancing it. So when employees feel they don't have enough time to complete their workload, productivity decreases by 68%. And since priorities are shifting unpredictably, to step aside and really gain perspective on what the different segments of your employees, from upper management to entry level, across all divisions, to see, okay, what are the priorities right now? Are there some non-essentials, some tasks, some things maybe you started before all the crisis started that you could put on the back burner for now? And let people know what their priorities are, because when you don't have that face-to-face contact and it's just emails and messages, could get confused. Some organizations have a morning meeting, per department by that manager, to say, here are today's priority, or weekly or biweekly, whatever works for your organization, to make sure that employees are staying on task, feeling like they understand what their priorities are, and knowing how to balance their life around that. Claims go up when employees feel that they're overworked and underappreciated. I actually consulted with a business attorney as well. Again, this is no legal advice. This is just research that's been done. An example of what PepsiCo did is they introduced the process shredder. They crowdsourced 260 employees, asking them to name one process that stops you from getting things done fast. For them, it happened to be the performance management process. So asking your employees, do you feel like you have too much work? Do you feel like the workload is not clear? Are you unsure of things? To get their feedback, like I said, how you want to divide that up and speak to them is up to you. But it really will help to understand how they're feeling about that workload, which is even more important than what their actual workload is. Next tip.
So definitely want to provide unprecedented flexibility to your employees. The more flexible you are with them during this time period, the better things are going to be in the long run.
Yes. 40% say they were left to navigate the challenges with inadequate resources. So as we know, I'm not sure everything happening in Washington, but especially in Southern California, vast majority of families are going to be educating their children at home. Multiple people are working from the same household, taking care of elderly relatives and parents. A lot has been happening. And so workers are resilient, but they need the right support. Even though we've been in this crisis for a while, there are some that are struggling to adapt to the new environment, and they're not being very verbal about it. They don't want to voice concern. They don't want to feel like a burden, but it's important that they're asked. How are you dealing with it? Are we providing you with enough flexibility? Now, obviously, telling everybody, okay, you can make your own schedules and whatever works for you, that might not be appropriate for your organization. And dedicating certain times when certain employees and certain divisions need to be at the computer at attend meetings is understandable. But maybe be able to say, okay, what about those are only Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays? Tuesdays and Thursdays, you have more flexibility. Or it's the morning time. Find out, take a poll. Find out when are people most crazed with the family and work life at home, and then get a little bit more flexibility like that. For example, since I wake up so incredibly early, I start my work day as early as 5 a.m. Now, it's my fault if I go till 5 because my supervisor doesn't expect that. But because that's when I'm most productive, I'm home. The afternoons are family time, late afternoons. That flexibility has been provided to me. Now, if there is an important meeting in the afternoons with different individuals within the organization, then I need to be flexible myself and make sure I can attend those. So again, it really comes to communication, seeing how the employees, what are they dealing with? And even just those conversations from manager to employee, from HR to groups, to say, how are you feeling about the flexibility? Is it meeting your needs? Brandman University actually sent out an amazing survey that really had to do with, okay, how are you doing? Do you feel you have the technology that you need? Do you feel that your supervisor is providing you with the flexibility you need? And it felt really good to be heard and then to find out, okay, what are the action steps that each department and manager can take so that an employee keeps their productivity up by feeling that they're being supported in the flexibility. An example is Google is showing its flexibility by postponing employee reviews. Facebook by giving every employee an exceeds expectations review for the first 6 months. Now that one's a little iffy because really we need to make sure people are still meeting expectations and maybe not everybody's exceeding them. It's even harder to manage and to make sure that people are being productive when in this work environment. But again, just ideas. Does anyone that's joined the webinar today have any examples of how their organization has provided flexibility to their employees that you'd like to share?
The rigid group.
No flexibility for you.
No one.
And I don't think I have my chat open, so. If one of
actually, wait a minute. Here's one. We just got one in the comment. Okay. They just did a survey about the impacts to working parents.
Nice.
Yeah, that's a big one nowadays, especially with the schools all up here in Washington all staying virtual for at least.
That's amazing. And I see that Leslie said too. We've allowed our staff to work at the hours that work for them.
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful. Works for them. Excellent.
Yeah.
Tip number three.
Ask for and listen closely to the feedback from your employees. So obviously kind of piggybacking on what the two comments we just got and what Brandman just did for us, this kind of falls right in line with that.
25% of employees are claiming that they feel undervalued right now. And that creates negative consequences for employers. Anyone who is a manager, is in HR, everyone understands, a business owner, you understand that employee morale goes way beyond just the feelings of employees. Not only is it about their productivity, it's about how they speak to and interact with colleagues, and how they're able to really bring down what could be a project, what could be a positive experience. And so by asking and understanding how they're feeling, sometimes that's enough. So a pulse survey is a good way to do that. And there's some examples on there. But 86% of corporate executive and employees say that ineffective communication is a big reason for failure in the workplace. So, for example, when this first started, our chancellor did a live Zoom meeting or broadcast for the entire university every Monday, 15, 20 minutes to tell us the status of what was going on. We receive an email about COVID and what's happening across all of our campuses every single day. It's a lot of communication. So I don't expect that everyone would do that much communication, but to make sure, like always, communication with employees is important, but communicating them and then keeping the lines of communication open so you hear back what might not even be said. Does anybody else have examples of unique ways that you're sending communications to your employees, that you're reaching out for their feedback? And has anyone done a pulse survey?
We did have one more. Lee said, I think it's going back to your previous one, but she just wanted to share, they have some great flexibility. However, a return to office guidance leaves something to be desired. We are being required to return August 24th unless we ask for accommodations. However, it feels as though there will be a stigma or attitude around those who need to remain working from home.
Mm, yes. Yeah, and actually we have some about that coming up as well.
Perfect. And then just a reminder to everyone, please use the chat feature for engaging in today's webinar. Both Emory and I will be queuing into it and responding and answering all of your questions live here. Thank you.
Excellent. So although in surveys, sometimes we hear back things that we don't always want to hear. We thought we were doing a great job at communicating. We thought we were providing the best flexibility. And it might not come back always as that, but that's okay. It is very important to share the results of the survey with everyone. That openness and that transparency builds morale, it gains trust, and it shows employees that employers are listening to them. So short and sweet does it. I'm satisfied, ask them if they're satisfied with how you're responding to the current situation. Do they feel supported? What should they be focusing on right now? Meaning, do they understand those priorities? Do they have the resources they need to do their job? And then an open-ended question that might get them to answer me more about what they're feeling right now. And that would how what would make you feel more supported right now? Like I said, it doesn't always mean large investments and things of that sort. It's about providing the different levels of support. Tip number four.
So use the engaging activities to tighten the bond. And actually, I will say that through the Zoom meetings that not only the chancellors had with us, but also we've had weekly with all of our supervisors and our colleagues, it has actually made us become tighter. We each other more now than we did when we were working from the campuses. So this is a good point.
Yes, absolutely. Because we have such a distributed model, with having so many campuses across multiple states, there are many people who I didn't know what they look like. I might communicate with them through email, and now I'm much more likely to say, let's do a Zoom meeting. I'm actually quite surprised that even with the partnerships I work with, how many people we had communicated through email, maybe did a Zoom meeting, but with no video. So now it's nice to know what everyone looks like and have that closer relationship. So employees do want to hear from their organization, but they also care about their colleagues. A lot of people found maybe some of their reprieve in their colleagues. They found support. It could have been emotional support, career support, by having those individuals to talk to, stop by their desk, water cooler chat. And so being able to have video conferencing, there's so many options now on how you can engage. For example, I use Skype, Zoom. I've used GoToMeeting, depending on who it is. So there's lots and lots of options. But finding new and innovative ways to do it. We did try having Friday for one of our team's Friday calls, having themes. So just out of fun, put a movie, your favorite movie as the background. Wear Hawaiian gear if you want to. That these things are not mandatory, but they're, you know, if you want to. I've heard of an organization that actually did coffee times. The manager, the high level, would say, okay, from this time to this time, I'm gonna open up my Zoom, gonna have coffee, and anyone can come chat with me. So many different options of how you can be creative to get individual organized. There's also different apps where you can do games, live games where you put the code in your phone and then it's actually being conducted virtually. Are there any other ways that you all have been able to really engage colleagues with each other for fun?
Oh, looks like group themed t-shirts.
Like it.
Yeah, that's a good one.
And celebrating birthday or work anniversaries.
Hey, Michelle.
Productivity.
Do you happen to have any of the game app names with you?
We'll put that in the recap email because it just escaped my mind. There's two that I know of.
Oh, somebody listed house party is a good one.
Oh, great. Thank you. And productivity improves by 20 to 25% in organizations with connected employees. So when people are having a hard time, and no one knows what difficulties people are going through at home, no one knows how hard this being at home all day, every day is for an individual. Some it might be fantastic, they adore it, and others it might be really, really difficult. So finding ways that employees feel like part of the group, that they feel that they're having fun when it comes to work instead of just sitting in these video meetings all day, is really going to benefit that morale overall. So LinkedIn, there we go, that's the one I was thinking of. LinkedIn hosts a virtual coffee hour twice a week. Low-key get-togethers, no one's required to do these things. They're fun engagement activities where they can drop in on the boss. I've also heard of organizations doing, you know, happy hour, people having lunch times together. Just depends on what fits and works well for your organization and how large you want those groups to be.
Here's a couple more, Michelle. Anniversary flowers to their employees.
Oh.
Spirit days. And then there's a new one. Afternoon tea monthly with the CEO via Zoom.
Yes. Those are wonderful.
That's a good one. I'll mention that to our chancellor.
I think so too. I really feel that this is the opportunity for us to get to know our employees better, get to see what are their lives like. You know, that's what we do just by seeing someone on video when their kid pops up or the cat walks by. Asking questions during meetings, maybe when you start a meeting. Hey, is anyone have a pet? Let's see them. Where is your favorite place to travel? There's quite a few fun, you can Google it. There's quite a few fun, engaging questions that you can add to meetings as well to kind of get that camaraderie. What's your favorite movie? And get people engaged in talking about themselves and getting to know each other. People will find similarities that they have. I also have one partner who's actually started quite a few groups. Now, the purpose of most of the groups is there's a business purpose, but like women in technology, actually, they do have a group about individuals who have young children at home, a support, kind of like a support network. You can always poll your employees and say, are you interested in starting a side group? And then giving them 1 hour a week in order to do that, you know, for their lunch break or things of that sort. But the sky is really the limit on how you can do that. There's a lot of companies out there, but there's also a lot of free options on how you can engage and tighten those bonds. So number five.
Oh, here's a huge one. You have to give yourself an emotional break. And
yeah,
we have been virtual since day one of COVID. So starting on March 12th, we started with virtual. And believe it or not, when you're sitting there every day going through the computer and doing things and trying to be creative and come up with ways of getting and reaching out to people, it becomes stressful. Everybody needs a break.
Absolutely. 87% of employees want employers to help them maintain a work-life balance. I'm definitely one of those. Almost 50% of workers say workplace stress has made them stop caring about work at some point in their careers. Right now, depending on what's going on in your organization, if there's had to be furloughs or layoffs or changing of teams and responsibilities and roles, or just plain people having to work from home or go back to work, this is the time where we need people to care more than ever. Everyone needs spirit-restoring breaks during all the crisis. But not everyone feels comfortable admitting they need it, especially at work. I'm one of those people. Go, 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 all the time. I can do it all. And recently, I had to say, okay, and in fact, my supervisor is the one who said, you work too much. You need to take the afternoon off. That meant the world to me. I knew I was working too much, but for her to notice and say, you've done enough, go take some you time. Wow, talk about building my morale. I already love Brandman, but talk about just really fostering that. Acknowledging stress empowers employees to do something about it. In a crisis, so it helps alleviate the feeling of helplessness is half the battle. So even by you, as an HR professional, the manager, the leader, colleague, by saying, I'm really stressed right now. You know, there's been a lot going on. Or I'm very worried about my elderly relative. Or, wow, it just seems like we have a lot on our plate. Acknowledging that you're human too helps each individual to say, oh, it's not just me. I'm not the only one who feels overwhelmed. I'm not the only one who's stressed. I said in the meeting recently, I said, I am really having a hard time. I haven't traveled. I'm an extensive traveler for both Brandman and personally. And so I admitted it in a group. I said, yes, it's hard. Everyone else felt the same. They were all avid travelers as well. And it brought us a little, you know, brought us closer. But to give an emotional break, that message really needs to come from top management as well, encouraging workers to take their breaks, take their vacation. Don't forget your lunchtime. Block it off on your calendar. Things like that. And to make sure that everybody knows of the employee assistance plan and what, you know, therapy and things that are available to them. There's also free resources online for that as well. Tips on how to support employees during a crisis. But really show them you're human too. We understand you might be overwhelmed. Take your vacation days. Make sure to take your breaks. Make sure to take your lunch. And we understand we're all human and we're all in this together. Any tips from you all? Oh, another one that I loved was one of my partners. There's a free app for meditation out there. And our at Brandman, we not only do we've had different unique webinars that we have for exercise, but we also have had a couple for meditation. But there's, I'll make sure this is in the email as well, but there is one of the meditation companies online did a whole free series. I think it was Headspace. Did a whole free series of meditations. Even in your newsletter, sending out a tip in every newsletter or once a week, once every couple of weeks about here's some tips for self-care is a great way to show, look, we care about you as an individual and about your emotional well-being as much as we do about the work that's being accomplished.
Yeah.
Any other tips about?
Yeah, Elizabeth brought up a good point saying that the Red Cross has free counseling resources.
Great. Thank you for sharing, Elizabeth. Any other tips about how you've helped your employees give an emotional break? At any time, if you think of something as we're going along later, it's not too late to chime in. So number six.
Oh, another big one. Show appreciation and support to your employees. I mean, somebody just said they recognized anniversaries. And so, you know, you need to reach out and let them people know that you're thinking about them. Give them the attaboy.
It's amazing what a text, an email, a quick call can do. 25% of people feel that they are undervalued, again, creating those negative consequences. Employees who feel appreciated at work are 87% less likely to leave their organization. Who doesn't like feeling appreciated? Give thanks and a job well done. I personally had a morning where I didn't think I did the best job in a presentation. And there were high ups at Brandman University and some of our partners at this presentation. And there was family things going on with an elderly relative in my life. One of the very high ups at my organization sent me an email afterwards and said, great job. Changed my day. I went from mentally beating myself up that I had not done the best job that I could have. Oh, I should have said this. I should have said that. Those couple words sent to me, great job, changed how I felt about that whole experience. So saying thank you, saying great job, saying I'm there for you to anyone in your organization. Also, what I've heard people do is to say, okay, you're working on a project with maybe somebody you don't usually. Finding out who that individual supervisor is and sending the supervisor a message of what a great job their employee did. Who doesn't like for their boss to hear kudos about them? If it's external partners or organizations that you're working with, to do the same, to send them a thank you that they've supported you and your organization during this. Encouraging employees to take opportunities for themselves. So not only with the therapy and maybe working out and different options like that, but really for career advancement as well. These chamber webinars are a fantastic example. Brandman University also has professional development webinars, but really encouraging them to take this opportunity to continue their education. Some organizations already have learning platforms that they use. Again, what works best for you and your constituents is up to you. But again, That's another way to show we appreciate you, we believe in you, we know that you can continue to advance yourself during these difficult times. Providing training and development keeps 86% of millennials from leaving their job. So just because it's crisis time, everybody's working from home, does not mean that individuals are not still looking to improve their career opportunities with you, to continue their education, learn new skills. Some people are having to because of the change in different departments or downsizing or adjusting to fit what's needed now. But by showing, again, that could be part of the newsletter. Here's a link to a YouTube video. Here's a link to a Brandman or the Chambers or someone's free professional development. Showing you care about them mentally, care about them physically, emotionally, all the different ways that you can. And again, whatever communication method works best for you. Some people use chat, some people use newsletters, some people use a weekly meeting. But collecting those and then keeping it consistent. So that you're saying, okay, here's an option for these different. Some partners that I see, what they're doing is they're doing they're picking maybe the first week of the month is mental health, then development, then physical health, and they'll give recipes or things like that. Some are doing that's a piece of the communication or the meeting during that you know, half an hour meeting. They have a few minutes dedicated to each of those things. Some are using internal methods they have, like their intranet, to have those, and they kind of have updates, you know, every day or every week on what those tips are. But there's a lot out there. It just depends on what do you feel fits your branding and your employees on providing those communications. So what ways have you all provided some of that support, that appreciation, opportunities for, you know, education and professional development?
Or are you being provided that?
Right. Yes, if someone does something nice for you. Emory always does nice things for me. He sends me a nice email. Thank you, Emory.
Yeah,
but don't do a good job, though. You should see what he sends. I'm just kidding.
No, don't do that.
No, we support each other. We have laughs together, too. That's part of that camaraderie that we have because of what Brandman's been able to build for us.
Yeah, Elizabeth chimed in, said they're encouraged to do personal development, to read articles and to learn.
Yes.
You have to. It's one of the things, and Michelle said that we do these webinars monthly. There's at least three webinars every month. I try to send the links to Crystal for you all to have access to. Now we're partners, so you'll definitely be getting a lot more of those, and they're free, and you can also go and do what we've done before.
Absolutely. And to time manage all these tips as well, another tip is that, let's say you're going to pull together, do the research, pull it all together for a time period. So don't every week look for a new fitness and health and mental. Try to make a list of quite a few at once, so then you could just pull from there. You know, that you'll have the next couple months, dedicate some time, get it all done. If not, then it gets a little chaotic, and where are you keeping all the information? And there's so many different resources. Personally, I love Google, because you can do a Google document, and you can have, you know, the different categories that you personally would like to share with others. And then as you find those resources, just pop it in there. And then when you have some time, research and say, okay, here are the best recipes, or here's the best free workout app. And keep it all in one place, dedicate time to it, add to it if you find others. But it gets kind of fun, to be honest with you, to find these resources for your employees. But we know you only have so much time, that there's everyone is stretched thin right now. So maybe you can get someone to help you, a colleague to help you work on this, or ask for others to send you ideas of things that should be shared with the greater community.
Now, Lee shared
number seven.
Lee shared something with us, mm-hmm. And I definitely want to point to this, because this is a huge program in Thurston County, and I'm going to give it kudos. Her agency sends a staff person at the agency's expense to the Leadership Thurston County program, and that's a one almost year long program, and they get a tour and talk about and meet and do things with all the businesses throughout Thurston County. It's a very huge program, and I've been begging for Brandon to send me. Yes, you're welcome.
Great. That's amazing.
It is. It's a great program. Look at this. Speaking include employee morale in your crisis program or crisis plan and programs.
Yes. So when top executives meet to establish a plan during a crisis, ongoing crisis, new crisis, the budget, all of these different types of meetings, they need to discuss more than just the bottom line parameters. It needs to include how to help employees dealing with crisis or work at home. Has to be part of the plan. Not just, and some of us, you know, some people just have to think of it on the whim, but really for the long run, it needs to be established on what are the procedures. There needs to be part of the budget attributed to it. What's the internal communication plan? And what's the timeline to meet employee needs? Now, late is better than never, but who knows what's going to happen in the future? And so helping the executives understand that these pieces, this morale, is directly correlated to the bottom line. Productivity, how turnover, retention, just how your organization is known, all impact the bottom line. Because often, at least what I've heard, is that these executives often say, oh, and morale, we have to get this, this, and this done. We have to keep the doors open. Of course you do. And of course there's going to be things like safety. You have to make sure everyone's safe before you can find out if you're going to send out an email about fitness ideas. But as part of the conversation from here forward to say, as we're talking about, okay, health and safety, how do we also include morale in that? There's a way to say, okay, we have done this for you. We have this health and safety protocols in place for you because we care. This is part. What do you think about these safety protocols? Again, you're wrapping in part of those employee morale boosting components while taking care of that top priority, which is safety right now. So I know it could be difficult to have those conversations and say, hey, we need to add this in, but there's definitely a way to mesh them together to provide employees with all of this as you're doing the most needed urgent tasks right now. So recap.
Well, look at all the things that Michelle just got through covering. Paying attention to your workloads. Providing flexibility to your employees. Asking and listening back. Making work engaging. I don't know if that can be done, but let's just try it anyway. Give emotional breaks. Show appreciation and support. And plan for employee morale, especially during the crisis.
Yes. And as I mentioned, there's a lot of resources out there. There's a lot of softwares and opportunities, but making sure that you plan for it, that you get someone to help you work on this collaboratively, that you don't take it all on yourself, and that you mix it in throughout the things that you're doing already. If you haven't done any of this that was chatted about today, no problem. You could start today. If you already have this all handled, well, beautiful. Then please do share us with some of the things that have worked best for you. I love the ideas that I'm hearing back from organizations. They've been so very creative in what individuals have been doing. For any of these, is there anyone on the call today that has other examples that they would like to share?
Yeah, Kevin typed up one, and I'll hit it real quick. They have a $100 given to each employee to pay it forward the way they see fit.
Oh, I love that.
I really like that one. That's a good one. I may pay it forward to myself.
That reminds me. Right? That reminds me. There are ways as well to give recognition. So we have, again, that's promoting fellow employees to give recognition for each other. I've seen everything done where people submit them and then, you know, one is drawn each month and that person gives a gift card. There's software, one's called Bonusly, where the employees can write up, it looks like a social media board kind of, and give points to theirs, and then that individual can save up and withdraw gift cards. So there's quite a few different ways to do that, but I love that $100 to pay it forward. There's also some organizations doing employee crisis relief, which is really beautiful. I know that I think Staples was one of them, where it's employees. This is a little bit bigger of an undertaking, but employees can contribute some of their own money to have an employee crisis fund. And so if there is an employee that is having severe crisis in their life and they desperately need funds, they can apply for that. And some of the stories are just heartwarming.
Oh, here's a good one. Staff Appreciation Weeks.
Ah.
Yeah, and the department.
That's a good idea.
And lunch for the entire office. That's a good idea. I know that the school districts all do Classified Week and Teacher Weeks. So they get the same thing, lunches and gifts and all kinds of things for those weeks. Those are good ways to say thank you.
And Brandman had also sent us little care kits. I thought this was quite kind, and it had some math in there. It had one of those no touch tools. It had some of the product, some of the things we already had, you know, like a water bottle and a pen. But number one, getting something that's not a bill in the mail was a lot of fun. And number two, it was just being able to, it was very thoughtful, is what I felt. Didn't know it was coming, was a surprise. Has anybody sent anything to their employees, whether it be virtually or in the mail, or to some of your partner organizations? I'm very curious about what others have done. I was trying to come up with a creative idea, I'll be transparent, myself, on how to send even to individuals in my life, some of my friends, something small and thoughtful, but I have been at a loss. So if anyone has any ideas, it'd be great.
I'll take that.
Now, I'm going to chime in. Oh, I'm going to chime in a little bit. So I know Alicia Blaine, the program director for Leadership Thurston County, the program at the chamber, she recently delivered a bunch of flowers to her board members, right? Engaging board members. And it was not, you know, a strategic plan. It was not something, you know, paper. It was just out of kindness. Oh, and she's chiming in and saying, and bottles of wine too. That always helps.
That's so sweet. Yeah. I love that.
Elizabeth said they're delivering cookies.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Oh, somebody, Amanda said they sent each in Venmo a few bucks and said, coffee break is on me.
That's a great idea, too.
No. Yeah. I'll take a coffee,
excellent.
Coffee, Michelle.
Well, I please. Ice, preferably.
We also have Kevin.
American workers. Oakland.
No, we have Kevin that chimed in again over at Print Northwest to support a local restaurant. All employees were given a $20 gift card earlier in COVID when it all started to open up to support
local. That's a good idea.
I love that because it's supporting locally and it's supporting your employees. That's beautiful. So American workers are demonstrating remarkable resilience, ingenuity, and commitment, especially when they feel valued by their employers. 94% of those surveyed say they are more committed to their company than they were before their COVID outbreak. This is one of the surveys that was done. So you have the opportunity right now to build value and commitment like you never have before. We hope that some of these tips have been helpful for you. Thank you for sharing yours. So when we spoke about the free professional development webinars, we'll make sure that's included in the recap as well. These are some of the recent ones. Some of them are directly related to skills like peer to manager, but we also had quite a few recently about social justice that were very, very well attended and very useful. All of our webinars they occur live, but then they're housed, they're recorded, so you can utilize them at any time. I do have organizations that are doing themes. So depending on what the theme might be, we probably have content that can support you with that theme or that initiative with what you're trying to communicate to your employees. And when I say content, I mean webinars, both live and recorded. We have some videos, we have articles and blogs. So please always feel free to reach out to Emory if you would like, you know, a little input on projects you might be working on. So this is the most fun yet. So as we're partners, with the chamber. The great news is all chamber employees and chamber members have access to scholarships. That includes member employees. So any chamber member, their employees also have scholarships available at Brandman University. They're for our AA to doctoral programs. And the nice thing is we obviously have them online. All of our courses were already online, so it's very easy that we moved over to everything being online. We do have self-paced options. We have term-based options. We have certificates. Now, these scholarships are for unit bearing only. So if it's a professional development certificate or certification, I apologize, those are already low cost enough. They don't have a scholarship as well. So unit bearing. I just want to make sure we're transparent from the beginning. Once in a while, there's a 15 or 20%, but our enrollment team can answer all of those questions for you. But just know you have scholarships available to you. They're the easiest scholarships you'll ever receive. All the ones I had to do in the past, I had to write lengthy essays for. I had to give my financial information. You do not. These are called Premier Partner Scholarships, and you can receive them simply by being a chamber member. All you have to do is fill out a form and put that would be your chamber member, put the chamber and put your business organization. Who is the chamber member? And that's all that you have to do. You will need to attach proof of chamber membership. So we'll have that on the back end. No financial qualifications, no essay to write, but you do need to fill out that form. Good news is we have, at Brandman University, we have help for every step of the way. So if you're just trying to figure out, okay, what programs do we have? We have enrollment coaches. We have people to help you figure out what the plan would be. And it is the one-stop person that will confirm with you the scholarship has been applied. Once that piece of paper is submitted, it's with you for the life of your program. So you don't have to keep, you know, resubmitting it every time, every session when you take new classes. It's a fantastic opportunity. Again, this is a good morale booster. If you want communications, you can receive them from Emory that you can send out to your employees saying, because we are a chamber member, all of the employees at our organization have access to these scholarships. Nice tidbit during these hard times. We've actually been quite surprised at how much, especially short-term programs, have really gone up in inquiries. People are taking this time to professionally develop themselves. That lack of commute, I think, has been a big one. And they're seeing, okay, my kids are in school. I should be too. So,
hey, real quick, Michelle, on that one, too. I want to point out that we are online right now 100%. Most colleges and universities are. But we do have the luxury in Thurston County to have a Lacey campus. So you can, once we do go back up and operational, you also have the option to go in there. Not only can you take classes there, but you can also get just support there. You can take all your classes online, but the campus can do your support for you.
Yes.
Sorry.
Oh, no, thank you. That's great. So what questions do you all have about either the presentation? Okay, scholarships, we'll make sure, so to reiterate, we'll make sure that you have the PowerPoint, that you have a link to the professional development webinars, a link to the Chamber Brandman Partner Scholarship landing page. That landing page will be a great place for you to, if you have any questions or want any information about the partnership, has the scholarship amounts. Again, I highly recommend to reach out to Emory at any time if you have questions for yourself or your employees for those scholarships. We will, what else? I'll find that meditation series that was specifically for individuals during crisis that I think might be helpful. Did I miss anything?
I think there was a question about the games apps of engaging fun games. Do you have access?
I'm sorry, would you repeat that?
The access to a games app. You have a games app?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, games app. Yes, thank you. So games and meditation apps. And then we'll do the scholarship information, webinar, professional development. Okay. So were there any new tips for anyone on the boosting employee morale today? Was there anything that you found especially helpful or things that you're going to take forward to your employees or colleagues?
Put them all on the spot, Michelle.
Right. Well, we hope that this did provide something that will be directly useful as soon as possible. And always feel free to reach out to us. We love to brainstorm.
I think it was most helpful, Michelle and Emory. I know every time there was a question in here and an idea, everyone was just chiming in. A very engaging audience today. So thank you, everyone. Lots of great ideas. So continue to boost that employee morale.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you all for your time, Dan. Thank you for the opportunity. We appreciate it.
Sure. So with that, if there's nothing else, Michelle or Emory, I'm just going to switch up to some closing slides here.
Perfect.
All righty. Give me 1 second. Okay. So once again, thank you, Michelle and Emory, for today's business essentials. It was a great topic today. Just want to remind everyone of some other chamber announcements that we have and some webinars that we're doing. We have Declassified featuring David Schaffer and Michael Cade every other Thursdays at 2 p.m. With that, once again, Business Essentials, we have every other Wednesday, which is what you all tuned into today. And thank you to our sponsors, Edward Jones, Dirk Farrar, and Jensen Milner, Cat City Law. We have a weekly virtual networking event, which is a very exciting and new networking event that we have. So the 1 minute What's Up every Tuesday at 2. And then the Chamber is really excited to announce a new 5-point business safety pledge. So we're encouraging all businesses within the community to self-certify your business. And this can be found on the Thurston Chamber's webpage as well. To certify your business that you are pledging safely. So when customers and other members come in, you can say that you are following these guidelines. So please reach out to me if you have any other questions regarding that. So in closing, I just want to thank you all again. Thank you to our panelists, both Michelle and Emory and Brandman University. Thank you to all of you, our listeners and our chamber members, and of course to our sponsors once again, Cap City Law and Edward Jones Dirk Farrar, for making today's webinar possible. As a reminder, the webinar has been recorded today and we will post it on the Chamber's YouTube channel, and it can be found on thurstonchamber.com under the Business Essentials webpage. And before we go, I will encourage everyone to download the chat feature. There was a lot of good ideas in there. So click those three dots in the chat and download that, and it can be saved to your computer. And so with that, I hope everybody has a great afternoon, and thank you again, Michelle and Emory.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you, Crystal.
Thank you.